Good afternoon, all of you. We are starting the next session, that is Magic of SICS. May I invite the chairpersons for this session? Dr. R.D. Ravindran as chairman. Dr. Jemesis Martinez from Mexico. He is invited as co-chairperson of the session. Welcome, Dr. Martinez from Mexico. Welcome, sir. Then convener of the session, Dr. Shekhar Paranspe.
Thank you.
Co-convener, Dr. Arup Bhaumik. Please, Dr. Arup. And I am Dr. Prakash Marathe as moderator. I welcome all the delegates here, and we are starting the session on time. I request all the delegates who are outside the hall to be in the hall. Panelists for this session are Dr. Mahesh Dalvi, Dr. Sunil Singh, Dr. Sajjad Fazil, Dr. Dinesh Gupta, and Dr. Saurabh Luthra. Dear friends, I think SICS is the popular technique nowadays. Most of the ophthalmologists across India and various parts of the world have been using this technology, and there are very good results. ISM-SICS is the body which is working on this, and I invite the chairman of ISM-SICS, Dr. Amulya Sahu sir, for introduction. Please welcome Dr. Amulya Sahu. Big round of applause for him. He has done tremendous efforts to take this movement ahead, and SICS is the technology which has to be proven across the world, but then some platform was needed, and this platform is given by Dr. Amulya Sahu, and we are thankful to Scientific Committee IOS for giving such platform for discussion on the topics of SICS on which most of the delegates are relying upon. Please, Dr. Amulya Sahu, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Marathe. SICS surgeons in India, we occupy 70% of the space. Most of our friends are working in village level where electricity is not there. They are doing wonderful job. As we started the organization in 2005, I was the president of Bombay Ophthalmic Association, and I felt that SICS surgeons are feeling shy to tell that they are doing SICS. And it was really not, because all the people who are on the stage are doing FECO. And they are promoting their machines. I have this machine, I have that machine, and everything. They are hogging all the limelight and other thing, and making other people feel inferior. I felt this is the moment, unless we have a platform, then we cannot project these people who are doing honest, sincere work and maybe artists in their work. So that is why the idea was born, and we formed this ISMS, ICS. And everybody told that you are going against the tide. Some people wanted me to come to, FECO side, and I said, nothing doing. This is the what I see clearly. I must back it all the way. And the first thing is that we don't appreciate our own people unless the foreigners appreciate you. So I said, okay, let me not do any conference in India. And we went abroad and did tremendous conferences. So once that after 10 conferences, then we decided that now we must have Indian conference and we must do the world conference, so that when we have a powerhouse of SICS surgeons, why should we go anywhere to learn? Like it is now the American are learning Sanskrit, we have to learn Sanskrit from them. That thing is something very pathetic, you know. Every Western country is now teaching Sanskrit, and India has to one day go there and learn Sanskrit. That is because we don't appreciate ourselves sufficiently. Though we have all the talent, all the heritage, we don't believe in ourselves. So the first thing was to make our SICS surgeons have self-esteem and pride in their art. Before the FECO invent, there had been wonderful surgeons. They were not doing FECO, but we remember them and salute them. And so this is a art form of cataract surgery. Let the science exist, but you can't throw away the art. If I'm doing magic in my hand, what's wrong about it? So this is why the concept of SICS came, and we have established. Now all the countries all over the world is going to accept, as every state in our country have opened the chapters. Now young people will be trained. We are focusing now, taking it to the institutions. Everybody must be trained in both forms of cataract surgery. That's what I was telling them. Now, another point I wanted to tell you. SICS surgeon should never say that I am doing a cheap surgery. Never. You say, the patient come to you, not for your lens, not for some machine, is coming for good eyesight. And the moment you believe that you are giving them good eyesight, tell the patient, no patient asks. Because of our self-doubt, we say that no, this is cheap. If I do FECO, I will charge you so much. If I do SIC, I will charge you so less. You never do that crime. You say, you are coming to me, I am the best, and I will charge my price, this is my package. You select the package. Whatever lens I am going to put, none of your business. Because coming here was your journey. Now going ahead is my journey. My patient, I give him good eyesight, he will bring 2% to me. Why should I do anything wrong? Because of our own doubt, self-doubt, we are promoting machines and this, that, and that should stop now. Now one of my friend in Pune, Rajiv Rao, charges 2 lakhs for SICS surgeon. Nobody questions him. When he did that, he thought, I will do, maybe in a month I will do 1 or 2 in this package. But he said, when he did 4, he said, he called me back, said, do you know how many operations I did in smart incision with this? I said, 4 to 2 I have done today. So that kind of confidence you must have. When I met him for the first time in Pune, the way he told me, then I said, I must have the world conference here, because this is the man I want to salute. Because he believes so much, he never bothered to go to any conference, but his OPD is like a market. And he does only SICS. And now he is developing the software which the world will look up to him. He is so much, focused. So this is what we want. We must have self-esteem, belief in our art, and we must assert. Patient has no business to question what machine I have got. And that crime we have done by bringing machine to the center. Now the time has come, we must bring the surgeon to the center, and whatever magic I do, it is my art. If I feel that somebody needs a SICS, I will do it. If I see it is a FECO, I will do it. You must be a master, you must be a complete cataract surgeon, and nothing more less than that. So with this, I want all of you, SICS people, believe you are the best in the world and things will follow. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sahu sir, for wonderfully elaborating the topic. Now I invite the next speaker, Dr. Purvi Bhagat. She will be speaking on pre-operative preparation, special emphasis on MSICS. Till she occupies the dais, I request next speaker to be ready, and he will be Dr. Shakin Singh, autoclaving and OT preparation. The timing allotted for each speaker is 6 minutes.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I'm very thankful to AIS and the International Society of MSICS for including me in this important session. I'll be talking on the preoperative preparation for your patients who are going to be taken up for an SICS surgery. We all know by now that cataract surgery is a surgery of great precision. The patients are concerned not only with the visual acuity that they are going to gain, but also with the quality of the vision, the recovery phase, and how fast are they going to be able to resume their activities. And preoperative assessments forms an as integral part of the entire cataract management protocol as much as the actual surgical skill. It consists of history taking, ocular examination and investigations, lab investigations, and most importantly, the documentation. Because of constraints of time, I'll not go into all the details, but only highlight the salient features which are important to us for our SICS surgery. History taking is something which should not be considered only a part of the residency program or something which you only do as a first year resident. It is a vital and core component of your entire cataract surgery management. The things we need to focus on for the post-operative outcome are the profession of the patient, because it is going to depend on what is the requirement of the patient, how much is it dependent on the glasses, and what are the requirements. Second most important thing is you need to find out the expectations after the surgery, because expectations and counseling are directly proportional to each other. More the expectations of the patient, more is the time and efforts required for the counseling. And if the patient has undergone a cataract surgery in the other eye, please spend some more time asking in details about the outcomes, what IOL was implanted, what was the post-operative course, and which type of surgery was probably done. Coming to the systemic history, apart from the routine diseases that we ask for, specifically ask for certain medications, like in elderly males with prostatic problems, you may need to ask for systemic beta-alpha blockers, diuretics, because they may be a trouble during our surgery, and if they are on long-term steroid use in any form, because that may hamper with the wound healing and modulation. If the patient is on any form of antiplatelets or anticoagulants, you may want to withdraw some of these for fear of hemorrhages, but please remember 3 things regarding this. One is always withdraw the drug if needed in consultation with the physician and the treating cardiologist. Second is never fail to explain to the patient regarding the restarting of the drug. And third is always document your omission and restarting of the drug. Because if the patient fails to restart and ends up in some thromboembolic catastrophe, then we'll be in a problem. So always document that the patient needs to restart the drug after the surgery. Coming to the ocular examination, of course, a binocular corrected visual acuity and good refraction of the eye, which is going to be operated if possible, but also always do a good refraction of the other eye, especially if it is a case of pseudophakia, because that will guide you what type of a post-operative refractive outcome and IOL you would require in this eye. Lint and ICSA, of course, for any sources of infection, which you would obviously treat before the actual cataract surgery. And also remember that a healthy tear film is equally important for the wound healing and modulation. So if a patient has a case of severe ocular surface disease, again, you might want to treat this prior to your surgery. In the conjunctiva, see for the health and overall virginity of the conjunctiva. If there is scarring from previous trauma or surgery or blebs are present, then you may again consider a change of site of your peritomy or the tunnel. And in fact, if the bleb is non-filtering, you may even consider a combined procedure in these cases. In the cornea, see if it is a high risk for post-operative corneal decompensation, and if the patient has high expectations in these cases, do a topography, do a specular, document all your findings, and again spend some more time in thorough counseling of the patient, and especially for the possibility of a post-op corneal edema or a prolonged post-op course. See for the AC depth, if it is shallow, it is an intumescent cataract, you may even consider a per-operative or pre-operative injection mannitol so that you can get adequate space in the AC for manipulation. And if it is a case of non-dilating pupils, synechiae are present, may consider the use and standbys of expanders, rings, and hooks on your OT table. If there are any signs of zonular dialysis, as in case of trauma or pseudo-exfoliation, again, you may want to consider rings and segments on your OT table, and even other types of IOLs as standbys. And in all these high-risk cases, please liberally use OVDs and use a good viscosity agent. Of course, the lens grading is important for planning your size of incision and surgical modifications. This goes without saying, a thorough posterior segment evaluation. If the fundus is not visible, then even a B scan needs to be done. If there are any pathologies which may warrant treatment before your cataract surgery, please do that first. And of course, this will guide you regarding the further visual prognosis. IOP always to be measured in all cases, especially if there is any suspicion of glaucoma. And if there is any borderline cases or stamped glaucoma cases, please do the IOP monitoring after the surgery. Don't think that your cataract surgery is done and the patient has normal post-operative outcome and you forget the IOP. Please follow up post-operatively also. Lacrimal patency can be simply done prior by a Roplas test, a regurgitation test, syringing at all times to be avoided on the day of surgery. Please do it in the prior few days. In keratometry, if there are unexpected readings or gross asymmetry between two eyes, repeat your keratometry, confirm your findings, re-examine the cornea if needed, and also if needed, document a topography. Because the keratometry is the major investigation which will influence your size and site of the incision. Because you might even want to consider neutralizing the preoperative corneal astigmatism. Biometry, again, being a contract procedure not to be done on the day of surgery, and at all times avoid adopting a blanket policy. That is taking emetropia in all cases. Depending on the refraction of the other eye, the pseudophakic outcome in the other eye, you may consider your IOL power accordingly. Lab tests, as we do in any other intraocular surgery, I'll not go into these details. And again, on the day of surgery, please do not forget to do a slit lamp examination of the eye which is to be operated. So that if there are any fresh changes, any sources of infection which have suddenly developed, you might even warrant a deference of the surgery. And this will also allow you to reinforce the visual prognosis. And please, please always all document all the investigations and clinical features that you have obtained, interpret them properly and have them properly documented in the patient's sheet. And these also include the informed consent and all preoperative orders, especially regarding the administration and withdrawal of drugs that you have given. Because it goes without saying that what is documented has never been said to be done. So if you want success, do the preoperative examination thoroughly and do it yourself. Do not rely on the findings of others, especially the clinical examination. Spend some time to do it yourself. It will help you to keep the alternative strategies and modifications ready. And of course, to be prepared is half the victory. So spend some reasonable amount of time for the preoperative assessment. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Dr. Purvi Bhagat is the chairman of Gujarat chapter of ISMSICS. Are there any questions? Okay, okay. We can have panel discussion afterwards. Panelists are requested to be ready for the discussion. Now the next speaker, Dr. Shakin Singh Ji, will be speaking on autoclaving and OT preparation.
Good afternoon, everybody. And I must thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. This is a long topic given to me. I have less time. I would try to cover up in time. So excuse me if I'm extending the time. Basic ADI is to have infection control and a quality healthcare. In the new millennium, multidisciplinary team approach is the target. And basically the very first requirement in a hospital is that it should do the sick no harm. So starting with the autoclaving would include some mechanical working of a machine, cleaning schedule, validation with a Bovidec test, other test, preventive maintenance schedule, monitoring from start to finish of autoclaving. And two, decontamination of any item is the different steps is the cleaning and sterilization. Sterilization would be steam, dry, heat, or chemical. Disinfection is a high level or an intermediate level or a low level. Then if the things are ready for use and storage. And different items to be classified into the user system is disposable, which we can use as such. Non-critical items, clean and dry and store and use. Semi-critical items, clean, high-level disinfection or sterilization, dry and store. Critical item, clean, sterilization, dry and store. The different method of sterilization is a physical and a chemical method. The physical would include heat and radiation, and heat is a dry heat and moist heat autoclaving, which is most commonly we are using, and chemical is a liquid and gaseous. Ideal sterilization method is a highly efficacious, rapidly active, strong penetrability, material compatibility, non-toxic, organic material resistance, adaptability, monitoring capability, cost-effective. The basic mechanism of sterilization is to inactivate the protein into a permanently denatured or a temporarily denatured system. The different type of autoclave, we have a class N and a class B. The principle is a different in these two, is the gravity air displaced in class N and vacuum air removal in class B. Pre-vacuum cold air is possible in class B, which is not possible in class N. So is a pre-vacuum hot air removal, it's possible in class B. And drying effect is best with the class B. Specific use solid unpacked instrument only, but while in class B, we can use solid porous, non-porous, and hollow-packed and unpacked instruments as well. Time is less with the class B. Steam penetration is much more effective as when we use the class B autoclaving. It's the system, as all of us know, the system of autoclaving is a moist chamber and then the air is evacuated out. Sterilization method, we have a steam under pressure autoclave, or we have a ETO, or we have a plasma. Plasma is too expensive. That basically uses the steam, horizontal autoclave. The time is 25 minutes when the temperature is 125 centimeter, and advantages, lethal to all bacteria, virus, and spores. Item needs to be heat and moist resistance. All linen material instruments can be autoclave with this. And ETO is at longer time, low temperatures, toxic, but we have a 24 hours need a standoff time. Heat label instruments, tubing, and phaco vitrectomy and cryoprobes are used here. And plasma is a bit expensive, but it's really a good alternative method of autoclaving. And we have a chemical sterilization, which is for the instrument which we cannot use otherwise. Instrument and other item can be sterilized by soaking in a chemical solution followed by rinsing in the sterile water. The immersion time to achieve sterilization or sporicid activity is specific for each type of a chemical sterilant. Disadvantages, it has many. And if you think they have, if you go across their surfactant, COTS, organic acids, heat labile, halogen, alcohol, phenol, aldehyde, ethanol oxide, and oxidizing agents, they work on the membrane or the denature of the proteins. Chemical disinfectant most commonly used are isopropyl alcohol, sodium hypochlorite, chlorhexidine, povidine. And to check the efficiency of autoclaving, we have different classes of indicators, which are class 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Would check the system, would check the one-step or two-step or three-step autoclaving, or would have a challenge, process challenging devices like helix test, and the biological indicator is going to give us the whole check in the system. In a given CSSD, which is a Central Sterile Service Supply Department, we need to have one entry point and then exit from the opposite side. It has a zoning inside. This is a disinfection, cleaning, drying, packing, labeling, autoclaving as dry store supply. And in the NABH, we have a standard, which is a standard 7, which would include this CSSD. This is a surveillance of the CSSD system is by Vovidec test, Helix, and biological indicator. And coming on to the second part of my topic is operation theater. This would not include only the OT. It includes the patient and the OT staff, linen, instrument, and equipment, OT medicine, and IOLs, which we usually often we forget. So we need to have a care of the patient, general examination prior, specific examination, pre-specific, pre-operative specific preparations, and shifting to the OT. OT staff is limited to 5 to 8, awareness about the restricted area, OT protocols, handling of sterile equipment, emergency medicine, surgical steps, health screening, vaccination, safety of the patient, changed clothes, disinfected hand and feet, covered nose, mouth and head of the patient and everybody, medicine, IOLs, implant, etc. We need to have an OT medicine which is included into a routine medication, specific medication for that specific patient, or a rarely used medication or emergency medications. OT implant with a toolkits, process of indenting, IOLs, all kind of IOLs in the inventory. Linen, instrument and equipment has a protocol for linen, protocol for instruments and equipments, usable or discardable, instrument disinfections, bacillol or liquid disposal management, washing, saline, ultrasonic, drying, pressure air or dry heat, packing with a chemical indicator, entry in autoclave resistor, labeled for load, batch time and date, defined shelf life, autoclaving, and then safe storage transport to OT. And the different type of OT, we have type C, type B, type A.
which is a different area, which we go across 400 square feet and 250 square feet and 150 square feet. And for this, we have guidelines from NPCB and from NABH. And we need to have a zoning in the OTV, which is very important. It's a protective zone, clean zone, sterile zone, disposable zone, and the system of a HVAC system. HVAC is AHU with the in and out ducts, AC compressor, air blower, pre-HEPA filter with 3.5 micron laminar airflow, plasma flow, plenum with a 0.3 micron HEPA filters. So these are the NPCB guidelines, minimum 260 square feet area which is required for an IoT, this is not for a general OT. The humidity is 20 to 60%, temperature is 21 degrees centigrade plus minus 3, air velocity at the plenum is 25 to 35 feet per minute, height should be preferably 10 feet, AHU filter with two set of pre-HEPA filters and one terminal HEPA filters, positive pressure 2.5 pascals, 5 to 8%, air changes is 20 per hour, 10 to 20% fresh air change 1 hour, equipment load for the electricity is 5 to 7 kV, lightning is 1 kV. This is the NABH guidelines, it's almost the same which have just been discussed. In the current practices, disinfection is used indiscriminately, used unnecessarily, not used when needed, concentration inadequate, use of unused and unsafe chemical due to economic reasons. Laboratory testing versus hospital condition may not correlate when you go in for the cultures. The cleaning protocol we have is for the roof, it's a 2% bacillol once in a 3 month. Walls, 2% bacillol daily wash, floor, 2% bacillol daily wash. Refrigerator, sink are to be cleaned daily, and sink are to be cleaned with the soap water, sodium hypochlorite, daily once. OT furniture, alcohol-based spray, daily once. Cleaning operating room and corridor, OT floor is swept thoroughly and then floor, wall, doors mopped with 1% sodium hypochlorite or 2% bacillol. This is the picture of how we clean those. And this is a three bucket system, one with the clean water, the second with the bacillol, and the third with the dirty water. You start with the clean and then you finish with the dirty and carrying that with the mopping. So remember, only 1% of the microbes present on the floor are present. Usually use only vacuum cleaner, don't broom. It increases the bacterial flow in the environment. Do not disturb the roof. Water tank, sink and drain needs to be cleaned. Liquid soap and scrub solution dispenser should be cleaned and autoclaved weekly. Scrubbing sink must be cleaned daily with brush and powder, dried and mopped with 1% sodium hypochlorite. Between procedures in the operation theater, clean operational table, theater equipment with a disinfectant solution with a detergent. In case of a spillage of the blood, body fluid, decontaminate with the bleaching powder, chloride solutions. Always discard waste in the prescribed plastic bag. Don't accumulate biohazard waste in the OT. Don't discard discarded soil gone in the operation theater. Clean all the table, top sinks, door handles with the detergent, low level of a disinfectant. Clean the floor with the detergent, mix with warm water, finally mop with the disinfectant like 2% bacillol. Fumigation, biohazard procedure. But fumigation is sometimes required when you have a new OT to start with. There's a process of chemical mixed in a water exposed to elevated temperature, gaseous vapors generate decontaminated air environment. Formaldehyde is most commonly used, which is a carcinogenic, is not recommended nowadays. Procedures, clean washable equipment, closed door and ventilators, switch off all electric items and calculate amount required according to room size in cubic feet. Personal care wear, cap, mask, foot cover and spectacles since the gas is irritant and carcinogenic. Safe is the bacillol. OT surveillance.
I think time is getting
just
over.
Just one moment, sir. OT surveillance, we need a culture every monthly. This is from the head end of the OT table, microscope handles, instruments, FACO tray, main trolley, balls apparatus, crash cart, surgeon, nurse gloves, door handles, wall, terminal HEPA filter, scrub basin. And the validation of a HVAC system, schedule for HU cleaning, and HEPA record. Other important factor influencing the safety in OT and hospital environment, hand hygiene, soap, water, and common sense, yet the best antiseptic, so would help us a long way. Surgical hand wash, quality of water used is better is a distilled water. We use many tap water, RO water, chlorinated water, but distilled is the best. Surgical scrub are also available. Do we need a surveillance regularly? Yes, we need it. And operation theater checklist, time out for patients in name is eye, hand deck or mark, attached pulse oximeter, betadine cleaning and lids, and adenexa, local anesthetic, then bin number, autoclave sticker, color, taste in that resistor, basis, batch number, expiry date, blade, batch number and expiry, visco, batch, and all medication we use, we need to keep the record of those. And people involved should be confident with the protocol of fumigation, autoclaving, surveillance, calibration equipment, and AC maintenance. Important register we need in the OT's operation table, theater logbook, OT surveillance plan, autoclaving logbook, flash autoclave logbook, OT medicine users traceability. And court recognize, explain, act, because we are going to contribute to the state country epidemiological program, intermediate surveillance system, financing body, patient safety promotions, healthcare system, hospital, ambulatory services, nursing home, long-term care facilities. It's a multi-task activity, multiple partners, multidisciplinary team approach, multimodal strategy. A multimodal strategy would give us a systematic change and education, monitoring performance and feedbacks, reminders, and safe culture. What is important? In fact, everybody in the OT is important. Everything in the OT is important. I'm really sorry for extending much of my time, but it was too long a topic given. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sakin Singh. It was an excellent presentation. Now our next speaker is Biswajit Dev. He is one of the bright ophthalmologists from the east coast of India. And I saw his post in WhatsApp, and then I called him up, and followed he has the spark, and I have not been disappointed. Yes,
good afternoon, everybody. It's an honor to be here, and I thank Dr. Amulya Saul sir for giving me the opportunity. So I hail from a place where 95% of the patient opt for the rigid IOLs. So SICS is the mainstay of surgery there. And we have to innovate constantly to reduce the surgical time, to improve the quality of the surgery, and come out with the best result for the patients. So what's new about the anesthesia in small incision cataract surgery? So we must know the spaces, anatomy of the eye, where we are going to give the local anesthetics. So coming to the spaces, the most two important spaces are intraconal spaces and the extraconal spaces. And now the most common upcoming is the subtenon space, where we are giving the anesthetics. The historical background of anesthesia goes back to 1884, and there has been many modifications. So the types of ocular anesthesia, first is the general anesthesia, next the local anesthesia. General anesthesia is still needed for children and infants, anxious, apprehensive, uncooperative patients, mentally retarded patients, patients' preference. Sometimes they are very much afraid to lie down and cover the seat. Patient with painful arthritis, epilepsy, patient with movement disorders such as senile terminal Parkinsonism. The days are changed from full general anesthesia to now it has come to ocular analgesia and sedation, and under which we are performing the general anesthesia, and the surgery time is very less, so we can quickly finish the surgery. Local anesthesia, coming to that, first would be the face retrovalval block. When I was in Arvind, it was used a lot. It was a very less volume, 2 to 4 ml will be required to give the anesthesia. And it gives a very good akinesia, and ocular movements are totally blocked. I'll just run through the, now coming to the perivalvar block. Here it is given in the perivalvar space, and we use lignocaine and bupivacaine together because we need more volume, and sometimes the surgery time is more than bupivacaine gives a longer duration of action for anesthesia. It is given in the intraconal space. The advantage of perivalvar block is reasonable anesthesia is there, reliable anesthesia, injection away from the key structure of the apex, which is more dangerous in the retrovalvar block, and minimal anterior hemorrhage, and there is no rotation of the globe. We don't need to give the facial block as we give in the retrovalvar anesthesia. Now coming to the enigma, the subtenon block or the paravalvar. The paravalvar space is a very less space, and with a 2 to 3 ml volume of anesthesia, we can give a good anesthesia, and patient recovery is very fast. The minimal structural damage, and that is chances of risk is very less. eye is clean, after the cleaning the eye, conjunctive and tenon capsule, 3 to 5 millimeter from the limbus, we choose, and we are very careful choosing the which quadrant. As a strabismologist, I am very particular about which quadrant I have to choose. Is the inferior nasal quadrant is more important because there are the less structure are there. If in the inferior temporal, there are obliques are there and superior temporal also obliques. Inferior nasal, the less muscle structures are there, and we make a small opening in that space where we give the inject the anesthesia. There are different cannulas have come up for posterior subtenon, for anterior subtenon and mid subtenon. Even we can use the visco cannula for giving the subtenon anesthesia. I remember my first patient when I did, it was a topical phaco patient and patient was very uncooperative on the table. So patient was very apprehensive for the injection. So I had to give the subtenon block, and after I failed the EEGE, I continued giving subtenon block instead of retrobulbar or peribulbar block. I'll just go to the video. Here we select the space inferior nasal quadrant. We 3 to 5 millimeter. We just clean with the betadine. We make a small opening in the conjunctiva and then make a opening in the tenon space. After opening it well, we have to go deep into the along the globe. We have to create a space so that there are no tenons is there. If you don't go deep, don't create the space, the leakage will be more in the anterior part and there are chances of chemosis and hemorrhage will be more. So we have to go really posterior to reach that space and give the anesthetic agent, inject that agent there. After this opening, we just have to glide the scissor along the globe and make the opening there. And now with the cannula, we are injecting 2 to 3 ml of anesthetic agents, which gives enough anesthesia for the surgery to get over. And the recovery is very fast in this procedure. It is a simple, reliable anesthesia, relatively safe. There is no chance of globe perforation, and recovery is very quick. Contraindication is definitely infection chances there. If there are pre-surgery, already the eye is operated for RD surgery or other surgery, it is very difficult to separate the tenons there because there will be a lot of adhesions. So those patients we should avoid, and those patients who had infection in the eyes, that we should not do the subtenon because the chances of infection spread posteriorly is very high. Now next would be the topical anesthesia, either the topical proparacaine 0.5% or the intracameral anesthesia. Both are in adjunct very useful for the anesthesia. This is just a small video where we are taking the soaked xylocaine and putting in the conjunctiva at the incision site. Only we are anesthetizing that area with then we can proceed with the SICS surgery, and we have to constantly put the topical anesthesia proparacaine and we can proceed with the surgery. And we can quickly finish up the surgery, and the patient cooperation is very much required here. The disadvantage is no accommodation of the eye, not suitable for extended type of surgery. Less effective anesthesia than the subtenon block. Increased risk of surgical complication. It has been seen that more PCR occurs in topical SICS, and patients who are awake and talkative, they may distract the surgeon, unsuitable for less experienced surgeon. The adverse effect is epithelial toxicity.
Stick to your time.
Endothelial toxicity may be there for intracameral use. Intracameral anesthesia is very useful for in adjunct to the topical anesthesia. So these are the modes of anesthesia, and the enigma is the subtenon block and the topical with intracameral use. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sticking to your time. Our next speaker is a bright young man from Punjab. His father is in the forefront of SICS surgery, and he is also upcoming ophthalmologist with a lot of promise. Mr. Vikram Dhaliwal. He is involved in the ISMSIS. Vikram, please carry over.
Thank you very much, sir. Can I have my presentation? Thank you. Thank you so much. So I'll be talking on scleral tunnel making and its principles. The first self-sealing incision was mentioned by Kratz et al. In 1980, followed by McFarland et al. In 1990. They described sutureless incisions. And Dr. S. L. Palin invented the first chevron incision, and Dr. J. A. Singer introduced the first frown incision. This was a brief introduction about the self-sealing incisions. Now, what exactly is a self-sealing incision? It's a triplanar incision which closes on itself with the help of intraocular pressure. Basically, this is the trapdoor effect. So, this is a self-sealing incision. Now, to make a self-sealing incision at the level of cornea, limbus, or scleral, you need to know the anatomy of the limbus, the posterior limbal border, mid-limbal line, and anterior limbal border. A reliable self-sealing incision should have a square incisional geometry, relatively short external incision with a tunnel that flares to a larger internal incision for the engagement of the nucleus, and geometric external incision shape that lends itself to stretching. And this is where Dr. Blumenthal's radial cuts come into significance. Now, these are the aspects of a sclerocorneal tunnel: its size, shape, location, width, depth, and entry into the anterior chamber, the depth in the cornea. These are the 6 points which one should always remember before starting to dissect a sclerocorneal tunnel. The instruments required for a good incision are conjunctival scissors. They should be sharp enough. They should not be blunt. Castrovizio's calipers. Please make it a habit to measure all your incisions. 15 number Bart Parker blade or blade fragment with a holder, and that should be sharp enough, not to give a ragged incision. Angled crescent blade, 3.2 millimeter angled keratome or a 5.2 millimeter tunnel incision enlarger. These are the various types of incisions. We have seen smile incisions, straight incisions. Most commonly used are now frown, chevron, and U-shaped incisions, or a straight or frown with radial cuts. Because these are the incisions that limit your surgically induced astigmatism. Now, a scleral incision, this is how I design it. The distance from the center, distance between the center of the tunnel and the limbus is around 2 millimeters. Depending on how much SIA do I want from that incision, the length of the tunnel varies from 3 millimeters to 7 millimeters, although Dr. Sahu sir is now post-graduated to 2 millimeters also. The length of radial cuts should be between 1.5 to 2 millimeters. The radial cuts, if fashioned, they should be perpendicular to the limbus. If they are not perpendicular to the limbus, they are going to add up to SIA. If they are perpendicular to the limbus, they are not going to add up to the SIA. The depth of the scleral incision should be half the thickness of the sclera. So these points have already been covered. Now, contour the dissection with the regard of contour of the globe. So your crescent should not be like superficial at one point and deep at the other point. It is not going to be a good self-sealing incision than in creating more SIA. This is a pictorial representation of a deep dissection which could lead to scleral disinsertion. We can also go on with the surgery at this plane only, or we can change the site. This is a superficial dissection leading to buttonholing. So that is where lies the importance of going into half the scleral thickness. It should not be deeper than that. It should not be more superficial. And a deeper dissection leading to premature entry and iris collapse, leading to more and more complications during the surgery. DM detachment due to a blunt keratome, that has to be avoided. Now, to achieve emetropia, please calculate your personal SIA. Don't rely on the tables issued by others. Please calculate your own SIA for each incision. Center your incision along the steep meridian. Longer incisions produce more flattening. Posterior incisions decrease the SIA. Straight or frown incision are known to decrease the SIA. and scleral incisions, they minimize the suture-induced astigmatism. Thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you, Arik. Thank you for saving time for others. Vikram, it is good. Now, you listen to the few masters, and Dr. Buramani needs no introduction. So, he has been promoting this Blumenthal for a very long time. So, listen to him.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I request the next speaker, Dr. Biken Aksar, to be on the line.
First of all, I thank the organizers, the Scientific Committee of AIOC, for giving us, the ISMSICS, the opportunity by giving two big sessions. Now, the title of the session is Magic of SICS. So, I will have to show some magics. So, I am going to show the magic of anterior chamber maintainer. Though Dr. Blumenthal has not invented the AC maintainer, he has popularized the anterior chamber maintainer by continuously feeding the anterior chamber with fluid which is connected to the bottle at the height of say 60 centimeters. You are operating with positive pressure. There is continuous flow of fluid in the anterior chamber and you are working with a positive pressure and enormous space in the anterior chamber, and I'll just show you with few slides and videos how it helps the surgeon. Apart from hydro expression of the nucleus in Blumenthal's technique, the positive pressure gives enormous space and you can operate with the normal internal architecture without the collapse of the anterior chamber. Even the dissection of the scleral tunnel becomes easier because the walls are made taut and the dissection becomes very easy in the stretched scleral walls. There is one-way flow of the fluid, so organisms and debris are always washed from inside out and they cannot enter the eye. So it acts also as a tamponade against the bleeding. There is less chances of post-operative inflammation because always the flow is inside out, everything is washed out, and there is low turbulence and low fluctuations of the AC depth. So there is less discharge of prostaglandins and leukotrienes because there are no sudden fluctuations in the anterior chamber, and you can do away with viscoelastics. Without viscoelastics also surgery can be completed. The endotoxin loads vary in various viscoelastics because these are derived from animal proteins. Even they are provided as sterile substances, the proteins themselves can cause reactions, and many times the TAS is linked to the viscoelastics. I'll skip this slide and go to the next slide. There is less chance of expulsive hemorrhage because of the maintained pressure in the eye, and it keeps the pupil also dilated. The capsular bag also is distended, so the aspiration of the cortex becomes easier. The drugs also can be fed into the eye. If you put the drugs in the IV bottle, continuously they can be fed, and it acts as a surge suppressor even in case of phaco intensification. So phaco, if it is done with the AC chamber maintainer, the phaco becomes more stable. And in my opinion, you can continue the installation of topical anesthetics. If you are doing surgery under topical anesthesia, even if you put the topical anesthetic on the surface of the eye, because of the AC maintainer, it is not allowed to enter the anterior chamber. So there can be surface anesthesia effect without any intracameral entry of that drug. And in case of PC rupture, the positive pressure also helps you back. Many times it keeps the vitreous face intact, and very gently you can continue for surgery. I'll show you some videos. Now this is a small video clip, how the capsular access is done with AC maintainer. Now, there is no viscoelastic in the anterior chamber. I am doing the capsular access through the side port. So in a very controlled way, only with the AC maintainer pressure, the anterior chamber is maintained and you can continue your capsular access. Viscoelastics is not required. Now my side port here is very small. It is the MER blade is inserted to a small extent so that it remains a tight entry, and after the capsular access is completed, I again pass the same MER blade in the same port to make a complete width side port. Now here are few videos wherein how the AC chamber maintainer helps you. Here a rigid lens is put in the back, but somehow that time the PC got ruptured. So very gently, because of the anterior chamber maintainer, the AC was maintained, and you can gently take out the lens out of the bag, and again I have placed the same lens in the ciliary sulcus. You can see the PC rupture there. But with the gentle maneuvering, without disturbing the vitreous face, you could do that work. Here again, there is no vitreous disturbance, PC ruptured, but because of the AC maintainer, you can continue gently with a single port aspiration of the cortex. So after that, again, I have put a rigid lens into the ciliary sulcus. Now these maneuvers have to be very gently. If there is sudden opening of the scleral tunnel, then again the vitreous can come. Otherwise, the safest way out is put viscoelastic, continue your surgery. But because of the AC maintainer, you can continue gently with this way. Here again, the lens is implanted into the ciliary sulcus in spite of a PC rupture. Now, here the vitreous is already come out of the PC rupture. So I am doing anterior vitrectomy. This is a core anterior vitrectomy. So once the anterior vitrectomy is done, you may continue again with the cortex aspiration. Now here again, because of the AC maintainer, the environment is maintained. The remaining vitreous is not allowed to come out. So I am continuing with the aspiration of the cortex. And after the aspiration of the cortex, the lens is again implanted into the ciliary sulcus. So this is how, in cases of complication also, many times anterior chamber maintainer comes to surgeon's rescue and you can make the surgery safe. I'll skip this video also. I want to save the time of the session. There are various designs of the anterior chamber maintainers, but the most popular design is the flat one, lower one, which is a Blumenthal type. Another is a screw type, which is called as a Lewicki anterior chamber maintainer. So anterior chamber maintainer is not only for the anterior chamber maintenance, but it is for assured cardiac maintainer for the surgeon's heart. So with the judicious use, the surgeon can have a peace of mind, sleep peacefully. I request everyone to register for this conference of ISMSSS, which is coming up in Kolkata. Our partners are Disha Institute. The registration is available on the website, and even a person will be helping you out here for registration online. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ramani, for saving so much of time. Our next speaker is a master, Dr. B.K. Naik, the incoming president of AIOS. And once upon a time, we used to listen to him as a SICS surgeon. Suddenly, he switched into FECO, and then he said, "I don't know, I'm doing only FECO." Then somehow or other, we have reconverted him to SICS, and now he's a complete master. So welcome, B.K. Naik.
In the meantime, I request Dr. Ravit Ram to be ready on the dais.
Yes, good afternoon, friends, and thank you, Dr. Amulya Sahu, for giving me this opportunity. I am going to talk quickly because I know the time is running short. So this Blumenthal technique, which is very popular in this part of the world, and that is also known as mini-nuke technique. And in this anterior chamber maintainer, you have heard in detail from Dr. Bora Manish. I will not go in detail, but basically it helps you perform your surgery in a much better way and controlled manner. Even I use anterior chamber maintainer in all my FACOs, and in 95% of my FACO surgery complete without any use of viscoelastics. And so these things already been discussed. And now we come to the Blumenthal technique in particular. So various steps are very simple: introduction of anterior chamber maintainer, conjunctival, making conjunctival flap, capsular access, wound construction, hydro procedure, nucleus delivery. The two part that you are seeing, wound construction, nucleus delivery, are little specific to Blumenthal technique, which I will be discussing in more detail. Cortical aspiration, IOL insertion, hydration of side ports, cautery of conjunctival flap, these are all routine procedure. These are the certain instruments which are specifically required for the Blumenthal technique, apart from your routine cataract cases. The side port 20 gauge MVR blade is good enough because that exactly fits with the size of the anterior chamber maintainer. The conjunctival flap, fornix base, whatever is the size that you want to make. Now, wound construction also fortunately have been discussed in detail by Dr. Dhariwal. So I will just little differences which I will point out. Incisional funnel, external scleral incision, sclerocorneal tunneling, lateral scleral pockets, and internal corneal incision. The two part I will highlight more, because this again I will bypass because it was discussed about the astigmatic part, about the location. Now in this, usually these are the ones which either you prefer to do this or this one with the cut behind, backward cuts, because this will increase the effective size of incision but without increasing the risk of producing extra astigmatism. These ones should not be done. Now, just I said there are two main differences. I talked about tunnel and funnel. So this Blumenthal technique It is because what when we call is tunnel. Tunnel is the external and internal. Both are same, exactly same size, and so the sides are parallel. Okay. Now this in Blumenthal technique, it has to be funnel. Means internal opening will be little larger as compared to the external opening. So it is going in the form of a funnel, expanding inside. Why it is important? Because once the internal opening is larger, your nucleus will project towards that, get engaged in that, and then afterwards you start coaxing it out with the procedure which I'll explain. The other part with the Blumenthal technique is, which is also important, that scleral pockets, we talk about scleral pockets to be constructed. Now, a scleral pocket, what is a scleral pocket? I said this is the internal opening, this is the external opening, going a straight line. If it is these two points are joined by a straight line, means this is not a pocket. For pocket, you have to dissect further beyond this line, and this is known as scleral pocket. And why it is essential? Because the internal opening, the nucleus will project in that, get engaged in that, and once it is engaged, then this pocket will hold this nucleus over there. Because any slight force, if it is just like that, it will try to slip backwards. So to prevent that, and nucleus should get, means it can be engaged in that and will not slip back, that's why these pockets are important. So these two differences I thought from the we should highlight. And the nucleus delivery with sheets glide, transparent plastic strip which is 3 to 4 millimeter wide, 0.3 millimeter thick and 3 centimeter long, and gently you introduce into the tunnel. And what it does, that I'll just show you once the video is, just I have made a small video. And so interior chamber maintainer, for that the 20 gauge MVR blade entry is made, and this was a hypermature cataract. So I'm not going to show all the steps which is common for the other surgery. So mainly straight away I'll probably go to the incision part. Yes, so incision part, this is what we were talking about, that here the incision is straight line, then going radial cuts backwards, and you start dissecting. Now in dissection, see, one of the guideline that you are at the correct plane, you see the blade, how much it is shining. If it is too much shining, you are too superficial. If you can't see the blade, it's too deep. So it should be just vaguely, it should be visible like this. And once you reach the cornea, then you see the curvature of the cornea is steep. So you have to move little back forwards. Then only your plane will remain proper and you can maintain that plane. Now once you are entering, and side pocket already we have made it, once you are entering it, always cut while entering inside. Extend the incision while entering inside, not while coming outside. Because once you will not do that, then your incision will not be in the proper. Now this just bringing the nucleus into the anterior chamber. Once the nucleus has come into the anterior chamber, then it's after that the job becomes very simple. With the sheet glide, you put it in the wound, go behind the nucleus up to midline. So this will guide the nucleus into the internal opening of the incision. And with the force here in the side port, once the nucleus is engaged into this, then the fluid force, because of the anterior chamber maintainer, it will push it out, and gentle pressure over there at the back portion, and your nucleus is out. So this is, it looks very simple. And and after that, again, just insertion of implant and completion of the surgery. There is no sutures required. Conjunctiva, you can do cautery and seal it. Thank you very much, Dr. Amarli Sahu, and for the patient listening.
Wow, thank you so much, BK. Wonderful. So our next speaker is Ravi Trehan, and he is the chairman of ISMSIS in Rajasthan. And he has given a new word which everybody should know. It is not surgically induced astigmatism. He suggested it should be surgically corrected astigmatism. So that credit should go to him. When the word sticks, Ravi, please.
At the outset, I'd like to thanks AIOC and ISM6 for giving me opportunity to share my views on this topic. As Dr. Sahu sir said, we have to teach internationally what SICS is. So we are trying our level best to invent new things, new points to give comfort to our patient. Sometimes what we see after doing a very good surgery, even the patients are complaining, they are not feeling good, seeing good but not feeling good. So we are trying to find some things that can be helpful, and this topic is one step towards that. It is embryological consideration of conjunctiva in Tenon, management in manual small incision cataract surgery. So a little bit of embryology, only a slide or two. Main eye development is from ectoderm and mesoderm. Ectoderm of two parts, surface ectoderm. Tissues developed from surface ectoderm, conjunctiva, lens, lacrimal gland, corneal epithelium and epidermis of the eyelid. With neural ectoderm, ciliary body, iris, retina and optic nerve. Mesoderm develops in stroma of cornea, iris and choroid, vitreous, sclera and ciliary body. Just enumeration, because I want to show a basic point that these layers, mesoderm and ectoderm, advice to surgeon, even in general surgery, they cut in layers and stitch in layers. So what we want to do, little bit problem is when coming, during, I'm straightforward discussing closure of the incision. At that time, we reposit the conjunctiva. Some surgeons ballooning the conjunctiva by giving subconj injections. Some are using glue for that. And problems what happens, sometimes tenons retract. And when these tenons retract, conjunctiva comes in direct contact with mesodermal tissue, that is sclera. And then healing will be with fibrous metaplasia. This fibrous tissue giving all kind of problems to our patients. And that leads to symptoms of uneasiness as well as dryness. So what my technique is, you can see after completion of surgery, nucleus removal, IUL implant, we can see we will adhere this tenon separately to the limbus. But this adhesion is not simple. Some may suture, but my technique is we use heat cautery. And here point is, if we can measure the temperature of tip by trial and error method, we find that if temperature is below 70 degree, then only charring is not there. Otherwise, charring is there, and that will defeat all the purpose. For that, infrared thermometer we are using. So temperature of tip should be less than 70 degree. And after that, main important message what I want to give, conjunctiva should attach to conjunctiva. Epidermal tissue to epidermal tissue. And with this healing, number of symptoms, uneasiness symptoms will not be there. Second part of my talk is embryological consideration in cortex removal. Here I just want to show a slide on anatomy of the lens. Here we can see different stages of the different stages in development of the lens. In very first stage, that is the vesicle stage, anterior as well as posterior epithelial cells are there. Secondary stage, when posterior epithelial cells proliferate and becomes the primary lens fibers, these are the early secondary fibers and late. These are in circular motions. What happens, the lenticular arrangement is such a way that it forms the sutures. Anteriorly Y-shaped sutures, and posteriorly it is the inverted Y-shaped sutures. And one more finding what we have noted, these lens fibers, ultimately corticocapsular attachments are at the sutural places. So what we are doing, I'm just showing a very small video about this. As I mentioned, and as everyone is know, there are three sutures at the posterior planes, 4 o'clock, 8 o'clock, and 12 o'clock. So we just try to aspirate the lens matter or cortic from these points. 4 o'clock, 8 o'clock, and then we will aspirate the from 12 o'clock. We can see, this is the real-time video. We can see the time taken on these three places. It is more. And after aspirating from these three places, breaking these three adhesions, something, yes. Yes, this is the 12 o'clock aspiration of sutural material, cortex from the 12 o'clock. After that, the speed of IA will increase like anything. Now you can see the speed is increased because there is no resistance. So just carry home message from my side is this. You should try to IA on these sutural places, and after that you can carry forward your further work. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Trehan. Our next speaker is from Desai Hospital, where we are going to have the world conference. He is Dr. Arup Bhoumik, and he is going to talk about the irrigating Baptist technique. Arup, please.
Yeah. Can I have my presentation here? Yeah. Thank you for including me in this prestigious session. I am Dr. Arup. My topic is irrigating Baptist technique, and we used to do a lot of SICS. At least now the number is less, but still we are doing the SICS, and we believe that the SICS is basically incisional surgery, and the beauty lies in the incision. If you make a good incisional scleral pocket or scleral pocket, your incision will be your surgery will be very good and effective, and visual outcome will be very good. And MICS doesn't mean very small incision, it will be the perfect incision. Let us see the anatomy of the incision scleral tunnel. If your limbus, it is a limbus, your incision should be either 6 or 6.5 or 3 millimeter or 5 millimeter, whatever, it should be the main point is a found incision in the 1.5 millimeter. Your corneal, clear corneal valve should be 1 to 1.5 millimeter. And the important part is the scleral pocket. If we miss that, we can end up with a lot of complication during the nucleus delivery. This is the architecture of the nucleus, because during the nucleus delivery, the highest diameter of the nucleus should be rest on this. So you have to be adjustable this horizontal diameter of the nucleus into the scleral bed. You can see that animation. For the smooth delivery, you need to have a good scleral pocket, and that is marked in yellow here. And this is the animation. We use irrigating Baptist techniques. There is a irrigation, continuous irrigation. It increases the internal hydrostatic pressure, and there is a little bit of mechanical pulling. The nucleus is engaged. And the highest diameter, once the highest diameter of the nucleus is crossed, the inner lip and the scleral pocket, and then the nucleus delivery is very smooth. So the main important irrigating vector technique, nucleus delivery in this technique, is hydrostatic pressure, but it is not so important. Lower lid depression to engage the nucleus in the scleral bed or scleral pocket, and mechanical rotation of the left hand globe by the left hand, which facilitated the nucleus delivery, and downward and outward pulling of the irrigating vectors to have a safe delivery. Can I have the video, please? This is a real-time video. The rexis was done. We prefer to do a larger rexis in case of SICS, because we have to pull up the nucleus out of the capsular bag, and we prefer to single point hydro dissection. This is a single point hydro dissection. It is a cortical cleavage hydro dissection to lift the anterior capsule and the hydro dissection and lift the nucleus from the one pole and rotate the nucleus and bring it into the anterior chamber with the same cannula. Viscoelastic is given below and above the nucleus, and the forceps is holding the sclera here, and rotate the globe little bit downward, and there is a little bit of depression of the lower lip, and nucleus is delivered so easily. Can I see this? I can show you the globe rotation in the side view. This is during the exact nucleus rotation. After introducing of irrigating vectis into the anterior chamber below the nucleus, there is a globe rotation. You can appreciate the globe rotation, and now there is a little bit depression with the irrigating vectis, and nucleus is coming out very easily. We use forceps. Inert forceps basically. Now epsilon also making, we have no financial interest. This is a F109. This is a scleral forceps. It is a very good hold the sclera and or the all the limbal tissue, and very pinpoint, very effective for our technique. This forceps is very effective to hold the fix the eyeball and rotate the eyeball downward. Let us see that sometimes it's a slightly different scenario. You can see that there's a large nucleus, black nucleus in here. We need to have a very big scleral tunnel. So we plan to, you can see there's almost marking this. Yes, so almost 9.5 pupil diameter, and the you appreciate the nucleus bulk is almost 11 millimeter here, and we have to deliver the nucleus through the scleral pocket safely. So we try to make a larger incision, and this incision with counterbalance, we make a big scleral pocket. And the astigmatism of counterbalance this portion with this portion, and we will end up only 1.5 SIA and end of the surgery.
Arup, please stick to your time.
Yes. Just I am showing the video. You can see this is a very hard cataract. This same principle is followed. Large incision. I just showing that making the scleral tunnel on scleral pocket in this case, and goes up to the 3 and 9 position for the delivery of the very large nucleus. Yes, you can see that scleral tunnel and scleral pocket, and this is very important for whenever you deliver a very big and thick nucleus. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Arup.
I take the opportunity to invite you all in Kolkata, 29th November to 1st December for CCC 2019. Thank you so much.
So our next speaker is from Mexico. This is Pamela Carla. She is a very dynamic eye surgeon. Does a lot of instruction courses in Mexico, and she is going to be our focus for the South American countries. Pamela, please welcome. And just a minute, we'll announce some announcement that Buramani wants to do for registration, please.
Yeah. Dr. Arup told in his talk about the conference in Kolkata, CCC 2019, which is a comprehensive cataract conference, the third world conference of ISMSICS, jointly organized with Disha Eye Hospitals in Kolkata. The registrations are only online on the website www.ccc2019.in. But for those who have technical difficulties, we have help kept in this conference. The booth number is B78. It is under this building, booth number B78. The registration help is also available during this session now. Those who want to register, can take the help of the person sitting on our right side. He is helping with the online registration of the conference, so we can take the avail the benefit.
Yes, Pamela, please.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. I'm Pamela Gonzalez, and as Dr. Sahu says, I come from Mexico. I work at the Mexican Institute of Ophthalmology. First of all, I want to thank the scientific committee and especially thanks Dr. Sahu for the invitation. I have no financial disclosure, and well, we're going to talk about conversion from phaco to M6. I'm a phaco surgeon, but a few years ago, I was in touch with the M6 surgery, and I just got in love with it. So I started thinking, cataract surgery has evolved since its beginnings, when it started as an intracapsular surgery, afterwards as an extracapsular surgery. Nowadays, we have two options. We have phaco, and we have M6. So phaco or M6? So who said it had to be a choice? As you see, we have very different scenarios. For phaco, well, this is not just phaco, this is flax, femtosecond laser assisted cataract surgery, and in the downward picture you could see an M6 procedure. You need only your scope, your hands, and a small set of instruments. Who said it had to be a race? Who said it had to be one technique against each other? So we had a lot of different cataracts. Not all our cataract patients have the same cataract. We have a lot of different lens hardness, and we had a lot of different scenarios. In my country, as well as in your country, we have a lot of people with low income, a lot of people with no social security, a lot of people with no insurance. So they do not have the possibility or access to have a private cataract surgery. So what do? We cannot have phaco for everybody. We cannot afford a phaco surgery for everybody. So M6 has been my lifesaver, not only for my country, for my hospital, where we've been able to treat a lot of more patients, but also for some special cases. So recently, I had this case, and I thought it was perfect for this conference. So this is a patient, 58-year-old man with a previous radial keratotomy. His right eye, uncorrected visual acuity 2400, corrected visual acuity 2070, and as you can see, with a high myopia. Left eye, uncorrected visual acuity of 2060, corrected visual acuity of 2040. So I always tell my residents and my trainees, the first thing you have to do when you have a patient, you have to analyze the risk factors you have for your surgery, for you to be prepared for anything that presents. I don't know if it's the same here in India, but in Mexico, having a man scheduled for surgery, it is a risk factor, because men complain about everything. So I'm going to show a little bit about the surgery. So remember I told you it was a radial keratotomy patient. So as you can see, this patient had between 16 to 18 cuts. So I made my accessor report, and I decided to go through a scleral incision. I decided to go really slowly, made a very nice scleral tunnel, and after my capsulorhexis, I started hydrodissecting my cataract. It didn't look that hard, but when I started making my groove, and when I started separating the pieces, it was a dense cataract. Then I started my phaco. I put in a second instrument, and I just want to pause the video a little bit in here. I don't know if you were able to see that. I'm going to return it a little bit. So I'm starting the phaco, and if you can see, in the upper part over here, one of the cuts decided to open, and some of the water started coming up. So I stopped a little bit and started thinking, what should I do? I have a cornea with 16 to 18 cuts. I have a medium hard cataract. One of the cuts had already opened, even though I thought I made a small incision in my side port. The cut didn't hold, and water started coming out over there. So the first thing was to suture the cornea where it opened, and then I started thinking, what should I do? Will it hold if I put the hand pins inside? Will it hold? What happens if another cut starts opening? So I decided not to take the chance and to convert my phaco to M6 because I want to keep my hair on for a long time and I don't want to give my heart a rough time. So I decided to convert this to M6 because it was a difficult case. So I'm going to forward the video a little bit. As you all know the technique, and the previous speakers have told about it, I didn't need a very big incision since the lens was already split into two pieces. I took the two pieces out, I started flushing all the cortex out, and I had a foldable IOL for my phaco, so I just decided to go for and have the foldable IOL inside. So everything went smooth, I had a nice surgery, I had a happy ending this time. And I decided not to put any suture because it was a self-sealing incision. So I was really happy with my results. So what have I learned in these years about M6? And what have we, can I tell you about M6 in Mexico? Well, we are the first M6 training center in Mexico for foreign and national ophthalmologists. I just wanted you to share with you some pictures. We have every month different ophthalmologists, mainly from USA, that come to our center, see the patients, and they are amazed that we have hard cataracts. As in here in India, I've seen you have really hard cataracts also. Not all of our cataracts are seeing 2040 or less than 2100. So M6 is an excellent technique. So every month, different doctors come. We are still learning. We are learning every day. We are amazed with M6. Now we are training our residents to be complete cataract surgeons. Not only phaco surgeons, but M6 surgeons. We're not saying M6 should replace phaco, but a cataract surgeon must know M6 so he can be able to decide if what technique is better for the patients. I just wanted to share you our website. If you have the opportunity to visit it, we have a virtual classroom where we have a lot of M6 videos and a lot of things that may be useful for you. Thank you for all new friends. This trip has been really insightful. Thank you for your conference and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Pamela. It's wonderful sharing your experience with us. Thank you. Next, we are going to inaugurate a book. Please, this is Ruchi Goyal's oculoplastic book, which we want to inaugurate today. She has been consistently with. So this is a
center. Again.
Pamela, please come up. So our first speaker is none other than Dr. K.P.S. Malik, our first president of ISMSICS. So he is not only a powerful man, but he is a powerful advocate of SICS. He is going to talk to you on are site port necessary, beneficial. That's something interesting to hear.
Friends, audience here and dignitaries in the dais, the SICS, generally we make one side port. I use mostly the blue, the anterior chamber maintainer, so most my surgery with anterior chamber maintainer in SICS. Today we are talking with side ports are essential or beneficiary of benefit in SICS. So my topic is to support it that side ports help you in many ways. So you'll see that. See left side, if I hold the Sinski hook in the left hand, I have published a technique of bimanual rexis. So with one Sinski, with the cystitome, if I'm going from right side, side port, left side port, fixate my eye as well as control the rexis movement. So bimanual rexis, whether phaco or SICS, helps that you have two ports, one on right, one on left. Sometime the hand over hand movement, like you have the left hand and right hand, then it is easier without pressing the genoules, that if you use both the hands for rotating and bringing out the nucleus out of the bag, then your left hand side port comes handy, that you can use both the hands for manipulating lens out of the bag. And this is of course our delivery that we have modified Blumenthal, that we inject visco through the anterior chamber maintainer and the heart of the nucleus can be engaged and chip it off and do your, and see, this is the side port which is giving you the best irrigation aspiration, anterior chamber maintainer and a cannula which can go from right, left, anywhere in the sub-incisional, 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 11 o'clock, that if you have side ports, then you can reach everywhere with well-formed chamber. And if your phaco machine IA fails, then you can use the anti-chamber maintainer and one cannula. With same ports, you can aspirate the cortex, visco. And of course, left hand, controlling the, with the left hand side port, this milk will coming out, come out of this hypermature cataract. When we are doing this rexis in a person with a hypermature white cataract, so left hand, when you are doing rexis, the milky fluid would not block your view because left side port is giving the egress to the outcoming fluid or the white milky fluid. And of course that you can stabilize the nucleus with two hands, so left hand port is, again I'm using left side port for keeping control of the nucleus, which is virtually floats when all milk has gone, and anterior chamber maintainer giving so much BSS that it has to be virtually controlled, that, and these we call, you can use the lens glide here, but generally we use iris depositor most of the time on the 12 o'clock to deliver the nucleus. And once it is engaged, then you can chip it off again, and cartwheel it out. And the small pupil, when you have, then you have one port, of course, it for anterior chamber maintainer. This is to break the synechia and for stretching the pupil, that you can enlarge it. Again, the second side port on the left side. So if you have two side ports, then you can stretch the pupil, and then you can use the left port for pulling the iris towards you and doing the rexis. This we call pull and push, like that you pull the iris away where you are doing the rexis. So you can make the space for rexis. This is nucleus out from the back. And these patients, especially the soft cataracts, are a bit difficult to rotate and bring out. Subluxated cataract, the side ports, of course, there are many side ports to be used for iris detection. And this right side port to tilt the nucleus out, and then of course rotate it with the main port or the left hand side port. This is iris repositor to impale the nucleus and bring it out, and anti-chamber maintainer, I inject visco so many times when especially the cataract is hard and my incision is small. The small incision with the visco through the anti-chamber maintainer, you can
push. I think it's a wonderful presentation.
Thank you very much. So yeah. Just to say that side ports help. Thank you.
Sir.
Thank you very much.
Only thing we have to now focus whether the side port contributes towards astigmatism. Some of you can take up that challenge and find out how much it is contributing towards astigmatism. Now next speaker, we are just changing, breaking the this thing because our secretary of ISMSS, Dr. Parikshit Gokhte, is going to talk about our ISMSS journey. Parikshit, please.
Respected chairperson, sir, ma'am, and a hall full of great SICS surgeons, I'm just showing a small video about the journey and the future of ISMSICS. It's just is about 6 or 7 minutes. Please bear with me.
Sound, please.
Yeah.
Apologies for the
also.
To the era of manual SICS. Phacoemulsification is the accepted norm for modern cataract surgery. However, in the developing countries, phacoemulsification may not be appropriate because of high cost. Hardness of cataract may pose another problem. Manual small incision cataract surgeries provide a suitable option in these countries. One can achieve same predictable results along with almost the same surgically induced astigmatism. On the contrary, with advancements in SICS, the incision can be customized according to patient's astigmatism. The scleral tunnel is a stable incision. Advanced MSICS can be presented now as a premium surgery. MSICS should not be looked upon as an inferior cousin of phacoemulsification. MSICS surgeons should not consider themselves as inferior surgeons and should proudly present their different techniques. However, the learning process in MSICS is perhaps more painful. MSICS training centers are very few. ISMSICS was started with this aim of popularizing and training of various skillful MSICS techniques across the world. ISMSICS has achieved this goal to a great extent. Surgeons not only from developing countries but also from Western world are taking keen interest in learning SICS. Many phaco stalwarts are of the opinion now that every cataract surgeon must learn SICS. The formation of ISMSICS was first announced on August 28, 2005 in Mumbai in a live surgical CME organized at Wockhardt Eye Hospital. Since then the organization never looked back. Dr. Amul Yasahu is the founder chairman of the organization and Dr. Jagannath Boramani is vice chairman of the organization. The first international conference of ISMSICS was organized in 2005 in Beijing, China. Dr. Sahu took a delegation of about 30 surgeons, who enjoyed the warm hospitality of their Chinese counterparts. The second international conference of ISMSICS was hosted by Tun Hussein on National Eye Hospital, Petaling Jaya, Selangor, Malaysia. This was a 3 days event with wet lab, live surgeries, and scientific deliberations. The second edition of Journal of ISMSICS was launched in the inaugural ceremony. The third international conference of ISMSICS was at Makassar, Indonesia in August 2008. In fact, this annual conference of Indonesian Ophthalmologists Association and Singapore Society of Ophthalmology was held under the aegis of ISMSICS. Again, this was a conference with wet lab, live surgeries, and scientific deliberations. The 2008 edition of Journal of ISMSICS was launched in the inaugural ceremony. The fourth international conference of ISMSICS was in Egypt in 2009. This was jointly held with Egyptian Society of Cataract and Corneal Disease and the Italian Refractive Surgery Society. This was followed by fifth conference in Sweden, sixth in Philippines, and seventh in South Africa in 2013. Free surgeries were also done by ISMSICS surgeons. The camp was organized by KwaZulu-Natal Eye Care Coalition. Dr. Jagannath Boramani was the first editor of Journal of ISMSICS. Almost 7 issues of journal were published over a period of 7 years. ISMSICS experts were invited to conduct SICS wet lab during Asia-Pacific Association of Cataract and Refractive Surgeons annual conference in Kuala Lumpur in 2015. The first World Congress of ISMSICS was held in Pune in 2015 jointly with annual conference of Pune Ophthalmological Society. The event witnessed tremendous response from members of the ophthalmic fraternity. The event was attended by over 1,000 ophthalmologists from 23 countries. The Second World Congress of ISMSICS was held in Chennai in 2017 jointly with Arvind Eye Care System. There was participation from many countries again in this conference. During the Second World Conference in Chennai, ISMSICS made an MOU with Help Me See, an international NGO. The motto was eradication of blindness across globe and to promote surgical training in SICS. Help Me See has already developed a surgical simulator for SICS surgery. ISMSICS experts conducted an instruction course in World Ophthalmology Conference in Barcelona, Spain, 2018. As a satellite program, ASICS wet lab was arranged in Baracker Eye Institute, Barcelona. The first edition of the book, Master's Guide to Manual SICS, was launched at the hands of Dr. Rafael Baracker, organizing chairman of WOC 2018. These are the various CMEs conducted with our partner societies. ISMSICS has conducted these symposia in various conferences till now. We have partnered with AIOS since 2017. International chapters have been installed in Philippines, Mexico, Thailand, Australia, and UK. 22 states of India have a state chapter of ISMSICS and the rest are in pipeline. Affiliation with ICO, P, PG training programs across the globe and in medical colleges are in our agenda. Our third world conference is coming up in Kolkata, followed by Chandigarh, Madhya Pradesh. Sixth world conference will be held in USA with Dr. Bonnie Henderson as organizing chairperson. Come one, come all. Join us for this mega event. Register for CCC 2019 today.
I thank Dr. Boramani for providing all the slides and Bikram Dhaliwal for making the video. He has done a wonderful job. Thank you, Parikshit, for sharing this video with us.
Yeah, thank you, sir. And here from the ISMS ICS side, I would like to acknowledge, of course, all the great SICS surgeons and our presidents, four presidents so far, who have all been presidents of AIOS, Professor Malik, sir, Dr. NSD Raju, our present president, Dr. Kuresh Maskati, sir, and Dr. Devashish Bhattacharya, sir. So I would just like to conclude on this, that manual small incision cataract surgery is perhaps India's contribution to world ophthalmology, or more truly of Indian subcontinent's contribution to world ophthalmology, since our neighboring countries also do a lot of it. And it's not just an economical and an easy surgery, but is a classy surgery that has the ability to deliver refractive outcomes, as all our stalwart speakers have been speaking so far. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Next. Our next speaker is Ruchi Goyal. She is going to talk on MSIC capsule, hydro procedures, mobilization of nucleus from back to AC. Mobilization for nucleus from AC to outside.
So, good afternoon, everybody. So, I'll start right away without wasting much time. Now, the nuclear prolapse is basically in two parts. One is from the bag into the NTA chamber and then outside. So, an adequately sized rexus is important to bring the nucleus out of the bag. If you have a large nucleus like this, a rexus of at least 6 millimeter should be made. And if you have made an adequately sized rexus, just the hydro dissection would cause the nucleus to prolapse into the bag. After this, this is the Blumenthal technique which I have used. You can just put on the NTA chamber maintainer and the nucleus is pushed towards the tunnel. Now, engagement into the inner lip is only possible if you have an adequately sized inner lip, and the outer incision may be small, and you can chip out the nucleus, make it smaller, and you can deliver it. But if your internal dissection is not proper from limbus to limbus, this nucleus will not engage. In the previous video, Dr. Malik had shown that you can use two-handed maneuver to deliver the nucleus from the back into the NTA chamber. Now look at this rexus. Hydro is being performed. You see the nucleus doesn't tend to deliver out. So what you need to do is you need to enlarge this rexus. If you don't enlarge this, what is going to happen is you will damage the zonules while trying to deliver the nucleus out. So you would give tangential cuts to the Vana scissors, and this is a capsular rexus forceps which is used to enlarge the rexus. So it has been enlarged on one side. Raju, if you still feel it's inadequate, you can do it on the other side. After that, you should not give radial cuts, Raju, that's important, and you can bring the nucleus out. Now look at this incision. This incision, there has been a premature entry. So if there is a premature entry, the iris tends to plug into your tunnel. So it'll hamper the progress of the nucleus, since if your NTA chamber maintainer is on and you try to push the iris in, what is going to happen is there will be iris chafing and this iris is going to get traumatized. The best thing is you first put off the ACM, put the iris back, and then try to engage the nucleus. So this is how you do it. Now this is another case where there is an adherent leukoma, and in these cases it may not be possible to perform a capsular rexus, so you should go for an envelope capsulotomy so that you have enough bag also available, and at the same time the nucleus doesn't get stuck. So an envelope has been performed and the nucleus is prolapsed out into the NTA chamber.
An echo.
And you, then you can use any type of procedure. I am showing Blumenthal because I do that very commonly. Otherwise, you can use any procedure, may it be microvectors, may be visco expression, whatever technique you want to choose. I think subsequent speakers are going to show you different techniques as well. The advantage here is that since it is not visible well, the flow of the fluid will flow out the epinucleus. Now look at this patient where you have, this is a hypermature cataract. And if you see carefully, there is some subluxation. You're not able to do the rexus because of fibrosis of the entire capsule. It is better to cut with the Vana scissors rather than pulling the capsule. Bring the nucleus out, and in this case, if you use an entire chamber maintainer, you're bound to damage the zonules. So I've used a microvectus and a Sinsky hook. So this is a phaco fracture at the exit. So this is a small tunnel. The nucleus will break at the exit of the tunnel. So there are various modifications of all these techniques. Whatever is best is you can use. The best part is that you should try and learn all the techniques, because you know at times something may be useful in some situations, something may come in handy in another. So this is another way of delivering nucleus. That is, you after the capsular rexus, you break the nucleus into two pieces. In this case, you don't need to really go work on the side, the pocket side pockets, because when you're doing a phaco section, the nucleus is broken into pieces. So even if your side pockets are not dissected well, it is okay because your nucleus size would become half. Now, after you have you know, sandwiched the nucleus in between two instruments, now multiple instruments are used to break this nucleus. Various methods are there. You separate these pieces by injecting viscoelastic between the two pieces, and then you bring each nucleus. Now again, some people try again use a sandwich method to bring out each nucleus. Some people use forceps. There are multiple various designs of forceps to bring out the nuclear pieces. All the techniques are equally good. It just, what matters is how well you perform it. The only thing is lots of viscoelastic. Don't let the nucleus piece touch the endothelium and bring the nucleus out.
35 minutes.
Time is out, does it?
No.
Where is the... So this is the microvectus technique. Again, see, the you have to be very careful that your nucleus is in the, you know, when you're taking any, using any procedure, and you have, you want to take the nucleus out in totality, your inner opening should be adequately large. But whenever you are breaking the nucleus into pieces, even if your internal dissection is not that large, it will do. What when I mean to say is the inner dissection, I mean that your tunnel from this end to this end, this has to be large. Now, this is a patient with a preoperative filtering bleb already present. So here, if I just use the AC maintainer, maybe the pressure may not build up adequately. So the tunnel has been dissected, and this is again a hard nucleus. There would be synecdoche also sometimes in a preoperated trabeclectomy patient. So this is again hand-on-hand maneuver to bring nuclei out in these situations where there are synecdoche and there is a tendency for the nucleus to slip in back. And again, inject lots of viscoelastic whenever you are doing any such maneuver. And on injection of, the hydrostatic pressure was not adequate. I tried to prolapse the nucleus out and use the hydrostatic pressure through the ACM, it did not come out. So now I'm injecting viscoelastics, and instead of using just the Blumenthal technique, what I decided was to go for a microvectus technique. And so this is why I'm again and again emphasizing that you must be conversant with all the techniques so that whenever you want to switch, there is no confusion. Now this is a very interesting case, I think microophthalmia with iris polyboma. Here the time is up?
Yes, please.
Okay. Just one, this thing, that a message that whenever you have such a situation, just remember the nucleus size is large, the anterior segment and the posterior segment are small in size, so you must have a very large tunnel, don't make it very long. So this patient, I just wanted to convey that I should have converted instead of struggling with this nucleus. It's a very large nucleus. So I think we can just leave it here. And the take-home message is always assess your nucleus, your size of your exit and size of your internal capsular opening should be matching. Thank you so much.
Language issues. Thank you, Dr. Ruchi, for the feast of cases that you showed us. I invite Dr. Kamaljeet Singh and to talk about FACO sandwich. Okay, sorry. Dr. Krishna Prasad first on visco expression, then Dr. Kamaljeet Singh on FACO sandwich. Don't think we gave him
so I'll just be taking you through the technique of visco expression. Can I have the slides? Where is it?
Going off.
Third one. Okay. Right. Okay. Fine. Correct. There are two Krishna Prasads. So it's a technique that is well known, and probably that's what we tell our postgraduates to practice in cases where the nucleus is pretty soft. And it's one of the easy techniques which doesn't require a bimanual dexterity. So this is ideal for soft cataracts because here you are creating a vector for the nucleus to come out, creating a pressure inside and also creating a traction. And using the viscoelastic vector, you are expressing the nucleus out. So obviously you cannot use it for a very hard cataract. Not only hard cataract, the thickness of the nucleus. If the whole bulk of the nucleus is very big, then this may be a difficult technique for bigger cataracts. And this is probably, according to me, one of the Corlea-friendly techniques. Like, there are many techniques where the margin of error, okay, can be, I mean, it's not a very forgiving technique sometimes. For example, if bimanual, if you're cutting the nucleus into two or using a sandwich technique, you require a lot of great deal of surgical dexterity and sometimes a great deal of luck also for the cornea to be clear next day. But this technique is pretty cornea friendly if you choose your cases right. And what is very important here, the nucleus has to come and get engaged into the incision. Then only you can actually squeeze it out and the nucleus molds itself to the incision size and it actually squeezes out. So unless if you have a more of a tunnel, as Dr. Bacon I was telling, instead of a funnel, then your nucleus may not get engaged into the thing. It can keep on bobbing in the AC and can touch the corneal endothelium. So have the side pockets to create a nice funnel so that the nucleus gets engaged into it. I think the triad for the beginners is to have the visco vector. You use the viscoelastic very judiciously at the right place, especially at 6 o'clock on the sides, so that you create a vector. You pull up the superrectus suture and you have to depress the posterior lip of the wound for the easy egress. So this is a technique I'm trying to show. This is softer cataract. So you make a tunnel. When you make a tunnel, you make sure that you have the side pockets properly made. So you are creating a tunnel which is big enough for the nucleus. We expect around 6 to 6.5 millimeter size nucleus in this. So the side pockets are to be done importantly. And the rex is preferably around 6 millimeters for an easy expression. See, for the beginner, it's very important that in SICS, we have to get the nucleus out of the bag and out of the eye. These two hurdles we need to take care. So once you hydrodissect, try to minimize the nucleus size. It's very important that you do multiple hydrodelineation rings so as to make the nucleus as minified, as smaller as possible. So once it's in place, you put adequate viscoelastic between the nucleus and the cornea, because when it is trying to squeeze out of the eye, it should not rub the corneal endothelium. And then the incision size can be altered as per the nuclei size that you actually are seeing in the eye. Then you pull up your superior rectus so that the eye becomes really, you know, there's a vector which is trying to pull the, you know, nucleus out of the eye. And use your viscoelastic judiciously, put it at the sides so that you are pressurizing the eye, and also put it beyond the nucleus towards the 6 o'clock, then depress the posterior lip so that it exits very easily. this smooth, I mean, exit is very important, because if there is any problem there, then probably you are not very cornea friendly. Probably increasing the nuclear size to 1 or 2 millimeters more probably doesn't really make much difference than having a bad cornea next day. So the incision size should not be a your concern, especially for beginners when you are trying to give a good post-op corneal clarity. So again, another case where you extend the incision to make a rexis. Again, a softer cataract here, 6 millimeter rexis, and adequate hydro dissection and delineation. And you can probably, during your hydro itself, it's better that you sort of prolapse the nucleus out of the bag. If it is 6 millimeters, normally it does so. Then you can position it into the anterior chamber, but immediately put viscoelastic so that in no way it touches the corneal endothelium. So once you push it down, here if you are sandwich and all, will require a vectus to be put underneath the rexis where you can catch the iris. Here that problem is not there. So it's more iris friendly and cornea friendly, and probably beginners, this should be the technique of choice. And once you put visco, again pressurize the eye and depress the posterior lip with the cannula itself, or you can even use an iris repositor. And at the same time, you press further down so that all the epinucleus and all the muck flows out, so it becomes easy for you to do the manipulations. So once you do that, you can remove the cortex and implant the lens of your choice. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Krishna Prasad. Dr. Kamaljit Singh on phaco sandwich.
Thank you, Chairman sir. It's really a great pleasure speaking in this association. I was one of the beginners with this association long time back, and this sandwich technique I used to use about 20 years back, and now it is used only when you have a very hard cataract wherein the incision is small and you can easily remove this hard nucleus.
Harsh is also there.
So this is the technique I do, make a frown incision. In this hard cataract, you can see you have to make a good tunnel in these cases. A large tunnel is required, as was spoken by the previous speaker.
Just wait for the audiovisual, Dr. Kamalji.
Okay. So you, if you have a hypermature cataract like this, you make a bigger incision. You should not be shy of making even 6.5 or 7 millimeter incision. The good thing is to make a frown incision, which is large, and side pockets are very essential. And you cut while going down. And here you can see it's a hypermature cataract, so we have done a can opener technique in this. Because it is very easy to prolapse the nucleus out of the bag if you have done a can opener technique. You enlarge the incision to required size, rotate the nucleus, it comes in the anterior chamber, and then with the help of vectus and dialer, you just sandwich the nucleus and take it out very easily without causing any problem. So this can be done, it's very easy technique. Only thing is that you should make a good tunnel in all these cases in hypermature cataracts. Conjunctival cautery should be done. This is another case where a phaco sandwich technique has been done. A capsular excess is made. You do a hydro dissection, and after rotating the nucleus out, what you have to do is that here you just have a look. First thing that should go in the anterior chamber is the Sinsky hook and not the irrigating vectors, because if you are going with the irrigating vectors first, then what will happen, that it will, the fluid will go beneath the nucleus and you will push the nucleus in towards the anterior chamber. So here you have to take care that your Sinsky hook should go first and it should be there on top of the nucleus in the center, and then you put your irrigating vectors and then sandwich it between the two instruments, and then you can deliver the nucleus out, slide it out easily. See, now my Sinsky is going first, and now both the things are sandwiched, both instruments sandwich the nucleus and it comes out easily. It's a hard cataract, through a small incision it can easily come. Once you have learned this technique, then you can graduate to phaco section technique. So this cortical matter is then aspirated. This is another case wherein we are doing capsulorhexis. A large capsulorhexis is a must in SICS in hypermature cataracts. It becomes easier to prolapse the nucleus out of the bag through a large capsulorhexis. So you see the dialer has gone first and now the vectus is going in between these two things, nucleus is sandwiched, then you press the dialer and keep the vectus firm, it will divide it into two. So sandwich comes in handy to learn the phaco sandwich, this phaco section technique. You take it out like this, the second piece can be taken by visco expression. Or if it does not come out, then you can use a irrigating vectus. So this is how you finish off the surgery. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Kamaljeet Singh. And I invite Dr. Hassan. We're just having a small award ceremony for a minute. Dr. Hassan, Dr. Amulya Sahu Parikshit, and Dr. Boramani, they've just succeeded in forming the Egyptian chapter of the ISM-SICS. And they're installing Dr. Hassan by giving him a medal.
I request Dr. Hardeep Pukar, sir, to come on the dais and take the podium for the presentation.
I request Dr. Harsh Bhattacharji also to join us as chairman.
After the talk of Dr. Kudlu, Dr. Suhas Hardipurkar's keynote address will be there.
Thank you, sir. I think I have to go, no?
Devash is spotted you. I didn't see you.
I'll finish. You want to finish?
Okay, Dr. Hardipurkar, then I'll
finish.
It is appropriate for me to tell the story that Hardipurkar has been always there with us from the day one. From the Walker's Hospital, you saw his photograph. Though he is known as a very astute phaco surgeon, but he is with us always. Thank you, Suhas, for being with us.
Previously, SICS audience was very large.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for calling me here. In fact, I would really like to thank you because this is a perfect topic. Perfect topic for the day, because now with phaco, you know, literally reaching its zenith, where we want to be minimalistic, we have to stop and remember that, you know, there's something that we really consider.
Nice. Welcome to
see,
the
in the history, there have been major shifts in cataract surgery, and there was one from ECC to phaco, and it was very uncomfortable kind of a shift, because most of the doctors who were in ECC, they were very comfortable, and for them to shift into phaco was little difficult. And then there was another shift that was ECC to manual SICS, and it probably looked relatively easy. And then there was another shift from phaco to femto phaco,
again, that wasn't very difficult to do, but for some reason, it's not very popular. Among these, between these major shifts, you know, so the surgery has evolved today. In fact, the reason why manual SICS was more appealing because, you know, like many of them found it very comfortable to move into, and there was another reason for Indian subcontinent when we value for, you know, there's a lot of value for money, we are cost conscious, and we are able to achieve the kind of results that with FACO they did. In fact, some of my friends who do manual SICS for quite some time, I've seen the results, and I've seen such excellent clear cornix on the first day, so it's really wonderful. So like I said, FACO has almost reached its zenith today, and it is most appealing surgery for cataract. But the present day FACO, you know, the situation is to cause minimal to nil subconcaval hemorrhage, to make a very small entry like MICS, stay minimalistic so that surgery is quick with little regard for the after effects of strained wound. And that's very important because there are some issues with clear corneal wound. There's always a wound distortion, there's wound strength and stability issues, the endothelial protection, post-op wound healing, and tear layer stability. Now, all these things do bother us as FACO surgeons when we go on more and more clear corneal and try to put a lens through a smaller wound. Now, if you look at this film, it's so very easy for us to shift back 2 millimeters or 1.5 millimeters behind so that your wound is nicely covered. You know, it's a scleral wound. You make an entry which is not as inside as you do with your clear corneal. And the beauty of this is that post-op, this heals so well, and you can avoid the wound stress that happens. Now, this is a 2.4 incision. You can very comfortably go ahead. And in fact, the beauty of this scleral incision used for FACO is that you are at a much deeper level. You are at a level for most of the steps, you realize that you are doing them better. And the beauty is next day morning when you see that patient, his corneas are much clearer than when you do it with clear corneal FACO. And you know, always after FACO, you do see some amount of corneal edema on the first day or some amount of corneal aberrations that do happen. But all those things are just not there when you do your FACO under scleral incision. But what it requires is you have to make that conjunctival incision, and there may be a bit of subcontinental hemorrhage, but I don't think that should really be an issue because it all depends on how you look at it. If you have always thought ki FACO is you know, doing it without even patient realizing that something has been done on the eye, then that's a very small thing. See, now this particular step, you know, your cannula is flushing the posterior capsule at a much better angle than when you do it from the cornea. So all in all, I have realized that if we really shift back, there are a lot of things to gain. The advantages are the cornea remains much clearer through the surgery and post-op. The wound entry marks on the cornea are minimal. There's no foreign body sensation in the post-op period at all. The stable wound with minimal induced astigmatism, because today the issue with us is no matter how much you try to be minimalistic, the induced astigmatism is always there, and it is definitely forgiving for hard cataracts, because even if you use all kinds of viscoelastic, next day you do find your cornea under little strain, and that you can avoid if you are scleral. Now, corneal incisions are not as forgiving as scleral incisions. Corneal incision stretch leads to tear during implantation, whereas an incision you know, leads to increased induced astigmatism. Preloaded injectors, when you put those, you know, when you try to inject a lens, they stretch the wound during cataract surgery. and 2.2 normally never remains 2.2, it's always more. And the fundamental drawback is that when you make a clear coronal incision, the incision is not always flattened in its own axis. So the axis in which your astigmatism is induced, you really do not know. And of course, the wound burn is still a reality, especially when you're not taken proper care. The incision burns are most likely to occur with higher power levels and prolonged ultrasound times needed for brunescent lenses. Increasing the stroke length of the vibrating tip generates more frictional heat as well as more phaco power. You can realize it in this particular film. It's a hard cataract, I accept, and it's very properly done, but the amount of energy you're using is more. And when you're doing that, your concentration is all the time at the phaco tip. And we rarely bother to see what's happening on the wound. If you look at, what's happening, you'll realize that gradually the wound is getting scalded. And it can really be a disaster because you do phaco so that, you have a good self-sealing incision. But sometimes you can land up with this. And this is something you will never get when you use a scleral tunnel. Here the wound just refuses to close. So it's no more a self-sealing wound. And in fact, this is a very properly done surgery for a hard cataract, but the wound was never really looked at. And then you have to alter your method of suturing and take a horizontal suture. So all in all, this is not a happy affair if you have not taken care. And such are the instances where you can definitely do it with a scleral tunnel. So I think the time has really come for us to relook at this scleral tunnel if you want to achieve better results after phaco. And if we only shift back, corneas will shine again, wounds will be healthy, visual recovery will be faster, and surgically induced astigmatism will be definitely much more negligible, and visual satisfaction will definitely be higher. So time has come for us to shift to scleral wounds, and thanks to manual SICS results, because they have really achieved fantastic results and very minimal induced astigmatism even after using an incision of 5 or more millimeter size. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Suhas. There is something to be gained from both worlds, phaco as well as SICS, and it's nice to marry the best of both. Invite Dr. Krishna Prasad Kudlu to talk on phaco fragmentation techniques.
Thank you, sir. In fact, I thank Dr. Amulya Sahu and whole team of ISMS chapter, International Society, to give me this opportunity. I feel proud that way back around 22, 23 years before, when I did my thesis, SICS was the thesis and first man to do it in the state of Karnataka, and I was really struggling that how to do the thesis. Only Arvind just started doing SICS, and it was so difficult to collect data and doing this thing. But now it has reached the level, I think SICS is the way to go about that. So I'll be just trying to show few of my videos. Few of the videos I borrowed from few of my close friends also. No financial interest. So of course, as like the time goes on, now SICS gives a similar advantage like phaco emulsification. So the similar technique, of course, less surgical time, low cost, and wider applicability. Of course, country like this, when you're doing more and more number, I personally feel that I think this is the way to go about that. So I think phaco fragmentation is a surgical technique for lens removal through small incision, which is lesser than 6 millimeter wound. So what are the instrumentation you required? 2.6 mm tunnel blade, or 2.8 or 3.2 entry blade, dialer with a Sinsky hook, Vectis, either it might be irrigating Vectis, which is of different size available. So coming to the step, normally with the help of irrigating Vectis or with the simple Vectis, nucleus is expressed, halfway at the exit, and at the exit you have to fracture the nucleus into 2 to 3 pieces. So other half is once again pushed back into the entry chamber, making sure that you are not damaged to the endothelium, realigned, then extracted to the irrigating vectors. Of course, as I said that, the few things, I think if you, the best surgeon, I think there is no chance of your damaging the desmans. Only thing is, when you're taking out, make sure that you are not damaging any wound architecture. So this is the 5.5 mm SICS. I think bisection of the nucleus, grade 4 nucleus. So using viscoelastic in every step is the key. Then you can remove other piece. So from 5.5, now I'm going to 3.5 mm incision. So once again, the same technique. This is a little bit softer nucleus. Sometimes, as you all know, that when you're doing in the smaller incision, softer nucleus will be little difficult to take out the nucleus. You need to put more visco, or even with the help of Simco also, you can take out the remaining bit. I think if you like keep doing more and more cases, I think you can decrease your incision size. Then, see, this is the case of a mature cataract. So when you're doing bisecting, make sure that you are covering the endothelium with a good viscoelastic. Take out the nucleus. Good, a sufficient amount of visco covering both the endothelium, and you have to push the PC back. Then from 3.5, now we can do SICS through 2.8 mm incision. So when you're doing through 2.8, especially very hard nucleus, you have to take care, you have to put more amount of visco. So when you're doing with the 2.8 mm incision, the surgical induced astigmatism is always almost nil only. And I think just I was talking to Dr. Amulya Sahu, I have seen his video last time. I think he did a live surgery of 2 mm SICS. So this is way to go about that. This is my take home tips. Always, when you're doing smaller incision, keeping the capsular bag ballooned all throughout the procedure, deliver the nucleus fully in the entry chamber before engaging it, cut the nucleus into a multiple fragment, use viscoelastic adequately preventing the endothelial damage, the tunnel length with the adequate pockets to be made for a smoother delivery. Once again, I thank the organizer, especially Amulya Sahu and the whole team. In fact, I'm also Karnataka chapter chairman. We try to take this society into a different level. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Kudlu. Now I invite past president Dr. Kuresh Maspati for his presentation, and the next speaker in the line, Dr. O.P. Agrawal, to be taken over the president. Podium, and he should be ready with his presentation.
So this is the Maskati cannula for IA during the SICS procedures. Basically, there are three irrigating ports and one aspiration port. Sometimes things move too fast in a Simco cannula. So the irrigation is from the side ports and the aspiration is from the main ports. I moved around with different designs and I'm sharing them with you. So the aspiration is done from the main port, and there are three side ports. One of them is pushing the posterior capsule behind so that the chances of engaging the posterior capsule are least when you're doing this. The irrigation is connected to the bottle. So the irrigation comes from the sides, and the aspiration is through a 5cc syringe, which is held manually. So I experimented with long space between the irrigating and the aspirating ports. Then I gradually found that reducing the space was more helpful. So the advantage of this is, main advantage is the posterior capsule is pushed back. When the space between the irrigating and the aspiration is reduced, then it's quite easy. I've also made a few bent ones to take out the 12 o'clock, but I find that most of the time I don't need them. With the straight ones itself, you can get the 12 o'clock material quite easily. So you can go slowly in the procedure.
You can go in and come out. Anytime you find something not right, you can push out with the 5cc syringe and push the cortical material out from your aspiration port. Even if you go under the iris, you're pushing the posterior capsule with the irrigating central port, so it possibly never engages the posterior capsule. So as I said, I experimented with various lengths, long, short, before I hit upon the what I feel is the better combination, which I'll share with you now. Epsilon now makes it with titanium. I have no financial interest in the in this. So these are the earlier models. Now this is with a more triangular tip. This is the latest model, except that now it's in titanium. This is with steel. You can go in and come out multiple times. I don't take any side ports in my surgery. You can keep flushing out as you do. So the procedure takes 2-3 minutes more than with the Simco, but I feel it's safer, in at least in my hands, than a Simco is. So this is the model which I'm using, except as I said, now it's titanium. I can't afford them. They're about 5,000 rupees each, so I'm still using the stainless steel ones which he made for me before he switched to titanium. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful presentation and keeping the time. Dr. O.P. Agrawal, please. Yeah.
Good afternoon. At the outset, I think Manual Small Incision Cataract Surgery Society for giving me this opportunity. I am going to talk modified Fishhook technique for nucleus removal. What we need in this technique is only 30 gauze disposable needle, extra than all the instruments and viscoelastic needed for small incision cataract surgery. What are the steps of procedure? Number one is wound construction, which is same, capsulotomy and hydrodissection. Here, initially, when I learned this technique from Dr. Henning, Japan, Nepal, he used to use envelope capsulotomy technique. Then the most important is nucleus manipulation, and then the nucleus removal. The important step here is the viscoelastic in front and behind the nucleus to make the endothelium safe, and to push the posterior capsule behind the nucleus. And the removal of nucleus with the help of fish hook. This fish hook is prepared with 30 gauze disposable needle. What are the difficulties? Nucleus, sometimes the nucleus can fracture, but this nucleus fracturing is the advantage which I'm going to show what the modification is done by us. Sometimes the hook may engage in the tunnel and the PC rent, which is compared as all other small incision cataract surgeries. So I just want to show 4 minutes video. So this is the envelope capsulotomy technique. Here, this is how we have to prepare capsulotomy. And then with the help of hydrodissection, the nucleus is separated, and 12 o'clock 12 o'clock age of the nucleus is just prolapse from the bag. Rest of the nucleus is in the bag only. So this 12 o'clock age is prolapse from the break, from the capsular bag outside. Then viscoelastic is injected in the anterior chamber and behind the nucleus. Now with the help of fish hook, which is prepared with 30 gauge needle, please don't blink, otherwise you will not find where the nucleus is. Just insert the hook behind the nucleus, turn it, and nucleus is out. This is a very simple technique. With the help of this technique, we can deal any grade of nucleus, any grade. Even grade 6 cataract can be removed with this technique. What the modification I did in this technique, instead of envelope capsulotomy, I started using capsular axis for better IOL centration postoperatively. After capsulotomy, the nucleus is delivered in the anterior chamber. Viscoelastic is injected in front and behind the nucleus, and nucleus is removed in the same way. This is a hypermature white cataract in very corneal dense corneal opacity. In this technique, the nucleus is totally delivered in the anterior chamber and is removed with the help of 26 gauge needle. Here you can see the posterior capsule tear. This was already there. When I delivered the nucleus in the anterior chamber, I find that there is a big rent. But still, with the help of this, we can remove. Now, this is the video showing 4 millimeter small incision cataract surgery. The scleral tunnel is prepared 4 millimeter, but internal corneal tunnel is enlarged from this end to this. This is 4 millimeter. And here in cornea, it is bigger. Now what I'm going to do, this nucleus is engaged in the tunnel. And with the help of this fish hook, I just crack the nucleus. That is phaco cracking in the tunnel. And with the help of this, I have removed the nucleus, even very hard nucleus, with 4 millimeter external tunnel only. The engaging the nucleus and making it in small pieces is much, much easier without damaging posterior capsule as well as endothelium. So with the help of this, you see this very hard cataract that can also be engaged in the tunnel and can be cracked with the help of very small 30 gauge needle instruments. So cracking is very easy, and this cracking is done in the tunnel, is not done in the anterior chamber. So the chances of capsular rupture and endothelial damage is much less. Rest of the steps are same. Thank you very much.
Dr. Hopi. And with this, I thank all the speakers. I invite Dr. Amulya Sahu, Dr. Boramani to come up for a group photograph. All the speakers, please come up quickly for a group photograph. Dr. Ramurthy, you are not part of the group photograph. Dr. Ruchi Goyal can come up.
And before all of you leave, I'm just reminding you that the international meet of the MSICS is on the 29th, 30th, and the 1st of December 2019 in Kolkata. Please do come in big numbers.